Alright, this is John again, and we're trying a different camera this time. We're also obviously in a different place. Everybody's laid out on the red carpet. This was for other photographic purposes, and since I had these things out and gathered up for this photo shoot, I guess these are the things we'll talk about this time. We have here some Danish, Norwegian, and Dutch items that would have all still been used in the World War II period. Many of them were designed and built many years before, but they were still in use by the armies of those various nations as World War II came around. I'm not going to try to describe the individual things from here. I can get the camera down close, but I can't really manipulate them to point at things for you. So we're going to swing around to where we were before. But while we're here, we have a Danish model 1889 Krag infantry rifle on the top, with a round of its 8x58 ammunition underneath it, and the bayonet and the scabbard for that rifle also underneath it. Next down is the Norwegian model 1894 Krag Jorgensen infantry rifle, and underneath that is a round of 6.5x55 ammo, which they also used in these rifles, as well as the Swedish in their Mauser rifles. Underneath that is a Dutch model 1895 quote, Mannlicher, and that's the infantry rifle. That's a Landwehr example used by the Dutch home army, and underneath that is the appropriate bayonet and scabbard for that rifle. Below that, the short one is a Dutch model 1895 carbine, one of the several types of carbine they have, and I will have to look up which one it is. I know this is a KNIL carbine, which means it's East Indies Army. That KNIL translates to Royal Dutch East Indian Army in some form of Dutch that I will not attempt to pronounce. I did have ancestors from the Netherlands a very long time ago, and I cannot even try to speak that language. Down on the bottom left is a Danish Model 23 helmet, steel helmet. Next to that is a Dutch Number 1 hand grenade, right below the clip of ammunition for the Mannlichers. You've got a Danish Model 23 hand grenade next to that. Then a Norwegian Kongsberg Colt, which is the US 1911, as built by the Norwegians. And next to that is a Dutch helmet, and I believe that's the Model 1934 helmet. So these are the things that we'll talk about today once I get you moved around. Okay, so we're back in our regular hunting grounds here, and I brought over the Danish bits and pieces to look at first. So we have the Danish model 1889 Krag. I don't have my little pointer out. Not that I wind up using it a lot anyway. Like I said, the Danish model 1889 Krag, which was the first of the Krag Jorgensens to be accepted by a nation's military in 1889, obviously. This example was completed in 1899, I believe. This is the infantry rifle, which is a very long rifle. It's one of the longest smokeless powder rifles I have in my collection. It's got to be about a 32-inch barrel all the way out there. It has a metal barrel shroud on it, like the German Gewehr 88 and the Belgian Model 1889 Mauser. So you have a metal covering around the barrel all the way from the receiver to the muzzle, which acts as a handguard and a heat protector and to protect the barrel. But the metal handguard itself was found, or the metal shroud itself was found to be easily damaged, and rust would develop inside it. So that was not carried on in a lot of other rifles. You have the Krag Jorgensen Action with its side gate loading magazine. In the Danish example, it opens to the side in this direction rather than opening down as it does in the Norwegian and the US examples. So this little ball here has a little spring on it. You pull that back and then that pops the whole thing open, and it comes open and the follower falls, it comes out with the door. I have to look up here to make sure I can. I'm going to tell you, looking at these monitors when you have bifocals and then looking back down is not an easy trick. For those of you who are young, when you get old, bifocals suck. Anyway, you can load this magazine either with the the action open or the action closed as it is now. You just put the rounds in there. Here's a round, you would just dump it in there. And the follower is going to push it. It's going to go up around on the other side and feed into the feedway as you work the bolt. So as I push this close, you'll see the follower come out right there. So it gets ready to push the rounds up if we had any in there. The bolt is your typical crag action. There's only one locking lug at the front. The bolt handle itself serves as another lug right in this area. But you really only have the one lug that locks into the receiver recess. The extractor is a large piece on top. If you've seen people remove crag bolts before, you kind of have to pull it back here and twist it. I'm not going to do that right now. You can find another video where people do that. It's a little bit of a process. You have to pull and twist at the same time. This one has a nice big cocking piece on it with a knurled handle, so if you don't get a shot on your first strike, you can pull it back and try again. The safety here was added later. It was not original to these rifles when they were built. It was added in about 1910. So this one was rebuilt at the time. On the buttstock we have a unit marking disc, which has nothing on it on this particular example. Then come to markings and sights and things like that. I'm going to try to set the rifle up here. I tried doing this without having something to set the rifle on, and quickly learned that's one of the first things I need to get used to doing, is setting it up so you don't knock it over and everything else around you. It also gives us a little time to play with this camera and see if we can get closer to things to actually, so you can actually see them as opposed to the other videos I did. Oh, sorry, that's too close. So there's your rear sight. That's actually not bad, is it? Let's kick it back here to the action. And I want to look right here. Sorry, blast your eyes out. See if I can get this thing to focus. It's a little handy cam style thing. So if you can see right on the top of the chamber area there, and it's reading this way, there's a Crown 99 mark. And I recall reading a long time ago somewhere that that's the actual acceptance date of the rifle by the military. That's why I said this rifle was built in 1899. At least that's when it was accepted, in 1899. So should have been when it was completed. Now, if you know your history from some other military rifles, the build date and the completion date are not necessarily the same thing. Excuse me for a moment while I move my little rifle stands around. So we're going to go in the other direction. And I'm going to try to get the markings on the receiver for you. I think we might have them there. I told you about my old eyes, and I have trouble getting close enough to this monitor to see what's what. Anyway, you can see it was built at the, however you say it in Danish, but the Gavar Fabrik in Copenhagen. In 1898, it says there, and it's a Model 89. Well, we already know it's a Model 1889 Krag Jørgensen, and I just finished telling you that it was completed and accepted in 1899. So we got Model 89 there, but over here it says 1898. And that, I believe from reading the same thing, that's the date the receiver was built. So the date the receiver is built is not necessarily the date the rifle was finished and or completed. Makes a difference in this case under U.S. gun law, because if it's 1898, it's an antique. If it's 1899, same rifle, it's not an antique. I'd go with the 1898. Anyway, these rifles fired. Let's bring this over here. We've got a camera we can move around better. The 8x58 rimmed round, which may have been developed for a single shot before that, but I do not recall in history right now. I know it's a pretty stout round for its time. You can see this is not a military round because it has a soft point. And I believe it's dated 19... Well, that's dated 1928. I thought it was 1918. I'll bet you we can zoom in on that too. Some of you people who are rifle or helmet people are not ammunition geeks. And if you're an ammunition geek like me, head stamps are a big deal. So I believe this is a Danish arsenal from 1928. The markings look right. I would have to look up which one it is. But this soft point bullet is obviously not a military bullet. But you get the idea for what the round looked like. I've shot this one before. With my own hand loads, and it's a pretty nice shooting rifle that way. Now, to zoom back out a little bit, here we have the model 1889 bayonet, and it's metal and leather scabbard. It's not a very long bayonet, but it doesn't have to be because the rifle is pretty darn long. It's just got a little spring switch here that locks it in place on that bayonet lug, which I'm not going to show you because then I have to get all the way up to the end of that rifle and film that. But it's quite a neat little bayonet. We've got some... I wonder if I can... I better try to take the camera down to it rather than the other way around. Right here on the Ricasta we've got some nice markings, and I'm not 100% sure what they mean. There we go. Serial numbers on the pommel. Looks like there might be a unit mark on the one side, and I'm not showing you any of this. There we go. So this may be a unit mark of some sort that's crossed out. That may be another unit mark because the serial number is actually on the reverse side. And then we've got a little latch here on the scabbard that actually hooks into this thing. Old bayonets, if you don't collect them, are interesting. Old bayonets and old rifles don't always mate up the way they're supposed to. This particular example, I can get the bayonet with some force onto this rifle and this will click in place. But then I have to push this down and I basically have to use a mallet to drive the bayonet off the rifle. And yes, I know you're supposed to clean the slot here and everything. This one's been cleaned. It's just not a real good match for the rifle. Either they've both been abused during the years, or they weren't a real good match to start with. I mean, there was interchangeable parts, but there were some things that were better than others. Anyway, that's the bayonet and the ammunition and the rifle. Let's zoom back out a little bit. And we will get something different, which is an hand grenade. And this is the Danish Model 23 concussion grenade. It's simply a blast-type grenade. Not much in the way of fragmentation. This 20,000 leagues under the sea, it's a very steampunk-looking thing for people who are into that term. Sort of a 20,000 leagues under the sea kind of deal. There were a couple of versions of this made. Because of the paint job on this one with the black stripe up in this area, you can see it's mostly gone, but there was a black, there you go, there was a black stripe up here, and the gray, and the 23 on there says this is one of the training versions. Now these were built by the Danes before the war, and the Germans kept up the production line after they occupied the country and used them through the war. And apparently for a while they didn't change the paint jobs that the Danes had, so this could have been manufactured by the Danes before the war, by the Germans during the war. I'm not 100% sure of the mechanism. This appears to be a filler plug on the bottom. And again, this is empty. Sorry, it's out of focus, isn't it? That's what I get for looking at the grenade and not at the monitor. But it looks like you would pull... maybe use something on this spring to pull this pin out, and then you've got a percussion type plunger on there when you toss the thing. But it's a pretty interesting looking thing at any rate. Not one of your more common grenades. Although, you can get these trained versions, at least in this country, pretty easily. And there's one more thing in the Danish camp here. And that is also a Model 23, the Danish Model 23 helmet. Which has this very, now you know not to leave the rifle up there when you're not messing with it. Just put that over there. Sorry. I'm learning as we go. So you've got a very interesting wired shape to this. I'll try to get it so you can see it. So you can see how these ears are going to stick off the wearer's head. Almost like a Napoleonic bicorn, if you've ever seen the pictures of Napoleon wearing his hat. Makes you think of that. Looks like a pretty good protective helmet for its time. This device is the Royal Device of the Army in Denmark. There were later versions of this. I actually have a 2341, which is painted black. It does not have this device, and it has a slightly different shape, and it weighs a little bit less. But pretty solid helmet for the interwar period. You've got a slot here to put your strap on there to put it to attach it to your pack when you're not wearing it. Nice liner with the ears in it. Nice leather liner. Pretty decent chin strap. Standard buckle. One thing that makes these helmets unique compared to most others, pardon me while I search around in here for it, is that they're actually individually serial numbered. To my knowledge, that's the only helmet that ever has been done. You'll find, you know, parts numbers and things in there. If you get a US helmet, you'll get an NSN number in there. Now, I just saw this a little while ago. This is annoying. There we go. Okay, I don't think there's any way I'm going to get that on this camera. Right down here, my thumb's pointing at it, and I'm going to have to try to get that with a still camera later. But trust me, there is a number down in there together with the factory name, and I'll try to stick you a still in there. But that's pretty much the only helmet you're going to find that has a serial number in it, and kind of an interesting looking thing. Be right back. Okay, I was going to run all of these countries together, and then I realized that's going to be over an hour video, because I talk a lot. So instead, we'll just cut it off after the Danish one. We'll make three separate little ones here, and here's your bonus item. We have a postcard from World War I, Deutschland und Österreich, and I forgot to look what the phrase at the bottom means, and I can't even read it. I'm sitting here staring at the monitor, so... It's obviously a friendship with your allies type thing. It's kind of a neat little postcard. And see you on the next one.